Hello, everyone. My name is Taylor Bug, and I'm the marketing coordinator here at Cloud for Good. And I'm so excited to welcome you to our webinar, Salesforce for Nonprofits, Migrating from Razor's Edge to Salesforce. Your lines will be muted today, so please make sure to submit all of your questions using the Q&A box on your screen. For those of you who don't know Cloud for Good yet, we are a Salesforce implementation partner who helps those in the nonprofit and education spaces create more value. We do this by bringing over 10 years of experience working with every cloud and every use case to our implementations. We are innovating with our proprietary accelerators, which are specifically designed to help amplify our customers' digital transformations. We're also delighting our customers, and that truly shows through being awarded the Salesforce.org 2021 Education Partner of the Year and a four-time winner of the Salesforce.org Nonprofit Partner of the Year, making us the first and only partner to have received this honor. Here at Cloud for Good, we are not only your Razor's Edge migration experts, we're also your trusted partner for strategic enterprise CRM implementations. On the screen here, you can see a sampling of some of our recent nonprofit clients. And I am so excited to introduce you to today's subject matter expert, Dave Austin. Dave started his nonprofit technology career working at an organization that became a Blackbaud company. Working in that family for over 4 years gave him a great deal of insight and depth of knowledge of the products and platforms under that umbrella. And coming full circle after working at Salesforce.org and now at Cloud for Good for nearly 5 years, he's had his hands on these products for many, many years now. And today he'll give us an overview of how Salesforce's latest fundraising tools are helping nonprofits to be much more efficient, effective, and reach more constituents. With that, I'm gonna pass things over to you, Dave.
Thank you, Taylor. Today we're going to be talking about migrating from Razor's Edge to Salesforce, as Taylor mentioned. Welcome everybody, and welcome back if you've been attending this series. Great to talk to you today, and as Taylor alluded to, I've been deeply involved in the Salesforce nonprofit ecosystem for a long time, about 14 years. In that time, I've also been involved in the Blackbaud ecosystem, so I've been able to really juxtapose and see the intersection between the Salesforce family of product and platform, as well as Blackbaud, and helped a lot of clients to make the translation between the two. So why are we doing this this webinar today? Well, simply put, fundraising is Cloud for Good's bread and butter. As Taylor mentioned, we touch all of the Salesforce clouds and all different use cases, but fundraising is something we've done since day one and continue to do. We have been migrating folks for our entire time here from Blackbaud products, both BBCRM, Razor's Edge, as well as the online products TeamRazor and Luminate Online. We've transitioned over 150 organizations, and in our extensive history, we've created step and repeat accelerators so that clients can really make their way through the migration, and also once using Salesforce seamlessly, they're free for our clients, and we're going to look at a couple of those and talk about how those carry over to our actual migration. So we're doing this webinar to assuage the fears that naturally come from making a big move to a CRM. And today I'm going to try to help you understand the ways in which A, Cloud for Good is your ideal partner, B, help you to understand some of the differences and similarities, and give you a day in the life of Salesforce from the lens or through the lens of a Blackbaud user, and really hope to help you get some tips and tricks and prepare for that migration so that when you are ready to make that change, you're a step ahead or several steps ahead of the game. So hopefully that sounds good. I'm gonna really talk about a couple of those differentiators that I mentioned, what we call the Cloud for Good advantage. So for starters, we have a migration accelerator. So we're very familiar with the Razor's Edge data structure. And since that structure is static, what we've been able to do is create a migration accelerator. We do an iterative data migration whereby we do a sprint by sprint migration of data. So you have the data you need as you go through the various sprints, which we'll talk about in just a moment. And it makes for a much more predictable and faster migration effort. We've also developed a set of accelerators which helps you easily identify and visualize key indicators about your constituents as well as track their preferences, things that you would have historically handled with attributes. And the only reason attributes exist is due to the inflexible nature of the Razor's Edge data model, whereas Salesforce is exactly the opposite of that, allowing us to do things like create these accelerators. And of course, Cloud for Good staff, or as we refer to ourselves, goodies. All of our staff have either worked with or at nonprofits, or in the case of our higher ed vertical, higher ed. And we have an average of 3 Salesforce certifications per consultant, many with quite a few more. And that's a huge differentiator. The other big differentiator is our actual implementation methodology. So you'll note that every project across the top has a consistent project management function throughout, and you should expect that. We also include change management as a function tailored to every unique organization, depending on the type of change management that you require. But really where the secret sauce lies is that after discovery in the project, when we build all of our user stories, we work with and talk to all the different stakeholder groups and user groups. We go through a series of iterative sprints. We determine how many sprints you need. We go through design, build, and validate iteratively. So each sprint has a sprint demo, and you get to actually see what we've done, make sure that it matches your expectations, and then you get to do user acceptance testing. So you're giving us feedback, and we have that feedback loop throughout the project. It's quite a bit different than disappearing behind a curtain and having a big reveal and hoping everything works for you. And so that interactive and iterative cycle is really what makes our clients so satisfied with the end result. And then we support you through go live and transition. So that repetitive and iterative model is sort of as I called it, secret sauce, and really our secret to success in working with clients in the implementation. So I'm going to jump into demo, and what I mentioned my goal is for this demo is just to give you a quick day in the life of fundraisers, both in mobile and back in the office on Salesforce, and really try to tie it to some of the concepts that you're familiar with the Razor's Edge. And then after we're done with that demo, we will go into a couple of tips, things that you can do to help you prepare for your migration, and then we'll go into questions and answers. So if that sounds good, I'm gonna jump into my Salesforce environment here, or my Salesforce org. I'm gonna start on my homepage. So my homepage is tailored to my role. So what you'll notice about all Salesforce products really, but Salesforce Nonprofit Success Pack, which we're looking at today, because it's a Salesforce product, the entire interface is tailored and flexible. So there is no database view and web view. Every page, every record page that you look at, every report, every list view, every homepage is completely flexible and can be configured to match the way that I do my job. So at the very top left, I'm looking at my donations by channel, being able to do real-time evaluation of which channels are working, which aren't. I've got an assistant on the top right that's giving me some follow-up activities for my current donations in the pipeline. I'm integrating with my Outlook calendar in this case. I've got today's events, so the webinar that we're doing right now. I've got a list of tasks that I've got to follow up on. And I've got a feed over here, which is essentially like a social feed for all the records that I follow. I get updates. I can send notes to my colleagues. I can collaborate around my data, my donations, my households, my contacts. That feed is pervasive throughout all of my Salesforce interface. And of course, the tabs across the top are configured for the things I need to do. I've also got favorites. I can add a favorite to anything, even a report, so I can quickly get to it. And as my job responsibilities may change throughout the week, I can also edit this list of tabs. That flexibility also carries over to mobile. So imagine, if you will, that I am a major gift officer, and I'm on the road in New York. I'm going to visit my major donors. You can see I've got a task that's due for me today to go and visit one of my major donors, Adam Hill. So I'm on the train, I'm using my iPad, and I'm on my way to see Adam and talk about some of the gifts that we've got in pipeline. So Adam is a major donor, as I mentioned, and has made gifts in the past, but also has the gifts in the pipeline. So I also want to go and visit other folks as well. So I'm looking at my list of prior donors in New York. As you can see, Adam's at the top, and I want to drill into Adam's record because, again, I want to get up to speed on everything that's been going on with Adam since the last time we spoke, know when we might expect our next gift. acknowledge in person past gifts that we've received. We can see everything about Adam, including the fact that he's part of a household. So at the top right or the top center, you can see he's part of the Jacobs and Hill household. We'll go and look at that household when we get back to the desktop. But I do want to look at that list of donations, as I mentioned. So at the top, you can see that there's actually this planned gift, which is what I want to discuss. We're expecting that in 2024, but you never know with a planned gift in some cases, depending on the type of planned gift. But that allows me to get some detail on this gift, know what stage we're in. You can see I've got a number of stages across the top there, and really everything I need to know before I go and speak with Adam. As I'm looking at Adam's record, of course, I may want to reach out to Adam or log the conversation that I've had. Because of the nature of Salesforce Mobile, it's a hybrid app, which means it works with the software and hardware on my device. So as I leave this note, I can actually use my voice to text to record this note, which I'm doing now. So I've just captured a couple of words that I had there just so you can see how that works. So very easy to save time and get to that data very easily. As I'm looking at the details of his record, of course, I need to know how to get to see him. So I wanna go and look at his address here, and it's going to use whichever my preferred mapping application is. So I'm using my iPad, I'm using Apple Maps. If I were someone who used Google Maps, I would actually be able to use that. So whatever tools are most helpful to you and that you prefer, you can actually interact with those using Salesforce Mobile. So that's kind of a quick walkthrough of a day in the life of a major gift officer using Salesforce on mobile. Let's jump back into the desktop view here. And as the fundraiser back in the office, I'm gonna use favorites to actually get to that Hill and Jacobs household. So this is another differentiator here is that we actually have householding. So this is an account, which includes people. So this household includes Adam Hill, as well as the other members of his household. So Susan, Adam, and Andrea all live in the same household. I mentioned our badges or our accelerators. So these visual badges across the top are also telling me there's a child under a particular age in the household, that they are a major donor, a current year donor, and they have a planned gift in the works. So I know what these badges are. These are part of our business process as a foundation. I could also have tooltips that tell me. These can be based on formula. They can be based on field values, but it does give me a quick way to know who Adams, who the Jacobs and Hill household are to us. As I mentioned, we can also track their interests, their communication, support areas, et cetera. Drilling back into Adam's record, similar set of badges across the top. We can see areas that he has historically given to. We can see that we don't have any duplicates. Duplicate management is built in, so we're trying to keep data clean throughout the system, and Salesforce helps me do that. As I mentioned, there are a number of donations, so I want to jump in and show you and get you familiar with what a donation looks like. We already looked at that planned gift. I can see a list of all the gifts that Adam is tied to, whether he's soft credited or hard credited on gifts. He's tied to a foundation, so we can see a grant that he is, has been a part of. But let's take a look at a gift that we've actually received. We've got a $100,000 major gift that we received earlier this year. I can see stages across the top. So you're familiar in the Razor's Edge and Blackbaud world with moves management. A little bit different than Salesforce, and again, one of those things to keep in mind, we track those moves management stages on the gift itself. So think of this like a proposal. We had this gift before we received it. This record was created and we tracked it as an opportunity to receive those funds. So the various guidance for success and the various things that we as fundraisers need to do and look at are tracked on each one of these stages. As we scroll down, we can also see there are a number of people tied to this gift. So we can see not only soft credit contacts, but also, for instance, Lloyd Alberts was an influencer. And so we've also given him soft credit. So very flexible in terms of how you do that and what kind of relationships you want to tie to these gifts. Lloyd Alberts would be a great person to thank for influencing this $100,000 gift. And so it's great to tie him to that gift in some way. The actual soft credits, as you can see, there is a tool to manage these soft credits to very easily divide out soft credits by percentage or amount. Of course, a $100,000 gift is probably not going to come in one payment, and so we can break this into payments and Salesforce nonprofit success pack actually has a scheduler for that as well. If we were to receive an extra payment, we can write off those payments so we don't sit and wait for something that we've already received. And then of course, the fund. So Salesforce calls the fund a general accounting unit. Every time I talk to Blackbaud folks, they say, where's the campaign fund and appeal? This is the fund. So this gift is allocated four different ways. It's tied to four different funds. It was sourced from a particular campaign. So there's your appeal. This is the spring gala. So we actually initiated this gift after a conversation with Adam at our spring gala in 2017. We can see those payments and funds as well. We can do things like tie this to a project if that were related. And once we actually start receiving the payments, we'll actually create accounting data that we can export, which we'll see in just a moment when we look at reporting. So how did we learn of Adam? How do we actually go and find folks and do prospecting and research? Well, we do that with what we call list views, or as you know them, queries. So for instance, let's take a look at a list of folks that we've actually done a wealth screen on. We kind of know what their capacity is. Some of these folks we've reached out to before. Maybe we want to upgrade these folks in their major gift in the pipeline. And so we do this by doing a screen, a wealth screen, and using a list view or a query. So let's take a look at this query and just deconstruct it really quickly. I've got a number of filters. So I have filtered by all contacts. I'm using a third-party tool called iWave to do my wealth screening, which is integrated and automatically populates the capacity and donation total fields. So once I do that screen, I know a lot about these folks. I know kind of what I might want to ask them and what my target ask is, and I want to invite them to make a donation through an appeal. I also may want to look at these folks visually, so I can use charts as well with queries. But what really makes the list view different than most queries is that I don't have to save this as a list and then take it somewhere else and do something with it. I can actually interact with this list. So I could send these folks an email. What I'd like to do is add them to an appeal. So I've got a direct mail appeal coming up, and I want to actually just add these folks to this appeal so that when that direct mail appeal goes out, I know I've got the right folks with the right capacity for that appeal. And I also can track that that was the appeal that they may have responded to when they make another gift. So really tying this all together, I mentioned that appeal. Here's another difference that I think is one of the tips, very important tips, I think, for, errant click there, for preparing for your migration. I went a little crazy with my clicker. Let's jump into what I meant to click, which was the campaign hierarchy. So what I really want to look at is the top level campaign for the year. So the 2022 annual fund. And again, this is another area in which you'll want to be familiar with and start thinking about your year of fundraising to come. So once you're on Salesforce, your campaigns, of course, you're tracking the gifts that come in, the expected revenue, your campaign performance, all the things that you would expect to track on a campaign. But this is actually part of a campaign hierarchy. As I mentioned, this is the top level. The appeals are actually child campaigns. So let me just expand each one of these so you can get an idea of what I mean. So as you know, you may have myriad segments within a particular appeal. So as part of the 2022 annual fund, I've got a fall winter appeal. As part of that, I've got a major gift appeal. And as part of that major gift appeal, I've got several segments. So that really gives you an idea of how appeals tie to campaigns. Each one of these campaigns and appeals has a default fund. So again, we're tying together campaign fund and appeal, so we know where our gifts come from. We can know which efforts are more successful than others. You may have multiple packages as part of your direct mail appeals, and so we can manage those. This goes five levels deep. So as you start thinking about your fundraising year, think about how everything ties together. Think about how everything rolls up, and it gives you a much more visual way to plan your fundraising efforts using the Salesforce campaign hierarchy. So now I'd like to kind of tie this all together by jumping into reporting. Of course, there's a lot more to show, but these are really just the basic things that I wanted you to see so that you can understand how Salesforce is different and how it ties to some of those familiar concepts again. Jumping into my fundraising dashboard. So a dashboard is simply a collection of reports What's great about Salesforce for nonprofits is that you get a number, about 100 reports, just pre-built canned reports that you can then tailor and save in dashboards that you can automate and subscribe to. In this case, I've got a number of reports that of various different types with different chart types as well. You can see we've got a really linear tabular report here, which is my financial export. As I mentioned, those ledger entries that get created, my journal entries for the financial edge folks, you can export that tailored exactly to how the finance team needs it. I've got a very prominent horizontal stacked bar chart here to see my fundraising performance fiscal year over fiscal year. You can see 2020 was a big year for us. A rather simple report here, grants by stage. I'm going to actually drill into that. As I mentioned, you can subscribe to and automate these dashboards so that they drop into folks' inboxes as they need them. You may have folks that are not reporting gurus or even do any building of reports, but they need to see the data for a weekly staff meeting, for instance. So automating those reports and dashboards is really valuable. What we're looking at here is all of our grants by the various stages. So let's take a look at this and then we'll look at how we built it. So for starters, I'm looking at closed and open. So the grants that we've received and the grants that are not received. So you can see there are a number of different grants here in this report. I've also grouped them by stage. So the ones that are closed or that are open, we also want to see what stage those open gifts are in. And then of course the chart that is showing all of that. I can actually filter this report by clicking on any of these slices. But what I want you to see, actually more importantly, is how this report was built. I will anecdotally say I have heard from a Razor's Edge user when looking at Salesforce reporting engine say that the Razor's Edge report engine looks like a stone tablet compared to Salesforce. So I thought that was quite revealing, and I think of that every time I show this to Razor's Edge users. This is a report looking at donations. If it were looking at donations and activities, you'd see that as well. But the fields that I have over here to construct my report are based on not only donations, but everything tied to donations. So the donor, the staff person that owns this record, address information, payment information, who the primary donor is, since this is tied to an organization, really every field. So if I were wanting to add a column, I simply drag and drop or double click into the columns. Those columns reflect what's across the top here. The way that those columns are grouped is handled in this grouping section. Remember, we were looking at it grouped by closed or open and then by stage. So I've got two groupings, and then I'm filtering this report to show me all donations of all time with any status, any probability, but just looking at grants. So once I've set up the columns, those columns are then available to filter this report. So very, very easy to do that. And then once I've actually defined the report and filtered the report, I can then modify what that chart looks like. In this case, I like donut charts. I can choose what the legend looks like, where it is. You can even do conditional formatting. So there's a number of things that you can very easily do through drag and drop, no code. And then when I'm done, I can save those changes and run this report. So I'm going to close out, which takes me back to the dashboard that I drilled it into. Quickly wanted to show you what that subscription model looks like. This is essentially where I can have this report delivered. So weekly, every Thursday, 10 a.m. And then I can add other folks to this report as well into this dashboard. So that's essentially what I wanted to show from a Salesforce perspective. I'm going to jump back to my slides because the real goal here is to give you some comfort and some tips to prepare for your migration. So what we're doing right now is looking at essentially understanding the center bullet there, understanding how things work. But one thing that you can always do is analyze your data in advance. If you can minimize duplicates, that minimizes us having to do that, which is more expensive than you doing that typically. So really trying to get your data clean and in a good state before coming to us for the migration. We can give you tips and pointers on ways to do that as well, should you need some guidance. Understanding Salesforce campaigns, understanding Salesforce gifts, hopefully seeing those helped you to do that, but understanding the campaigns will help you to plan, understanding that they're part of a hierarchy and how appeals fall into the campaign structure very useful, very helpful, and can help with that migration preparation. And understanding the gifts, understanding how the campaign, fund, and appeal ties to gifts, understanding that when we actually do look at an opportunity or a major gift, like a proposal, we're actually tracking the gift and we're tracking lose management through the gift and not the donor or donor prospect. And we can help you with that guidance as well, you know, again, before the migration, and give you tips to help you prepare. There are also a number of tools and resources out there. Salesforce has developed a learning management system called Trailhead. So even before you're a Salesforce customer, you can learn about Salesforce, how to do things, learn about particular functions, preparation for your particular role. You can take a look at the Salesforce App Exchange, where myriad third-party and Salesforce developed apps that plug into Salesforce are available. You can also search consultants. You can find Cloud for Good on there and see what our rating is and see what our customers have to say about us and our specialty areas. And then finally, cloudforgood.com. We've got a number of customer success stories that will help you to find folks that might have a similar journey and story to yours. We also have additional resources like webinar recordings like this one, blog posts about Blackbaud products and Salesforce for nonprofits, as well a number of different guidelines and details about the various products that that we specialize in. So a great deal of information on cloudforgood.com. Highly recommend that you check that out. This has been pretty packed for a short period of time, but we've got a few minutes here for questions and answers. So I think we're going to go back on camera so that we can address those questions directly. I know Taylor's been monitoring chat, so if there are any questions from folks during this webinar, we will be happy to answer those now. Taylor, any questions for us?
Yeah, thanks, Dave. We have a couple minutes here. We did have quite a few questions that came in during the registration process. So I'm going to start off with a couple of those, and then we have one from the chat. So the first one, Dave, is what are your recommendations for a fast and smooth migration, specifically around like quick user adoption?
That's a great question. I did touch on that in various portions of this, but sort of to say in a consolidated way, again, data preparation and preparedness to understand Salesforce and sort of what it is and how it works will be of huge value for user adoption, because a lot of that information can be socialized internally prior to a migration. As well, we do provide change management. So we assess the level of need for that user adoption that you have and give you guidance. And we'll also tailor the training to what your training needs are, whether they be train the trainer or user guides, leave behinds, etc. So we can help you with that that user adoption and help speed that migration as well.
Awesome. We just had a question come in. What are nonprofits' biggest hesitations from your experience, what you've seen, Dave, from switching from Blackbaud to Salesforce?
That's a great, great question. And we do hear that question a lot. So one of the big things is that you know, folks have heard oftentimes from Blackbaud that you need a lot of different products to do a lot of different things. And it is true that Salesforce is a CRM and it does quite a bit, but you need an online donation platform. And really, I see that as an advantage in that Salesforce allows you to choose which tools are best for you. You're not forced into a particular ecosystem. Salesforce is also built to integrate. And so that Salesforce App Exchange is a great example of how things are built to tie into Salesforce. So you don't have siloed applications. Yes, you may have more than just Salesforce tools, but they are built to plug into Salesforce, which absolves you of having to do things like batch gift entry for online gifts, for instance. You obviously, we have use cases for batch, but you don't have to batch everything because it's built to integrate.
Great. Thank you so much, Dave. I think that does wrap us up for today. We're right at the 30-minute mark. So thank you for sharing all of your expertise. And thank you so much to everyone who is able to join us today. Our next webinar in this series will be in October after Dreamforce has concluded. So if you're going to be in the San Francisco area during the conference, please let us know. We'd love to connect with you all. I will be sending out a recording of this webinar, so be on the lookout for that. And if you have any additional questions, please do not hesitate to reach out, or you can chat directly with us at cloudforgood.com. Thank you all again. I hope you have a great rest of your day.
Thanks, everyone.